been working hard on the Series Rover this week. Chassis is now undersealed, looking pretty smart. Didn't find any rust at all really, bit of surface rust, that was it. Worst was that little corner brace below the brake pipe there. But again, it hasn't rusted through, there's still plenty of metal there, so it cleaned up well. I've used a bit of anti-rust primer on it first. So I'm well pleased with that. And I've even done the mounts on the tub. Just where they make the burn bright. Water tends to get in there and cause all sorts of funny things to happen. Anyway, today we're going to have a look at the clutch. The gearbox parts have now arrived. Very pleased with those, well packed, and they look like quality bits and pieces as well. That includes the spigot bush that goes in the end of the crankshaft, and that supports the floating end of the input shaft into the gearbox. So we're going to have a look at replacing that. But first we need to remove the pressure plate and friction plate of the clutch. It's marked up Borg & Beck, so it could well be the original. It really doesn't look like anyone's been in here before. I believe the engine has been out, but I don't expect the clutch was changed. It doesn't look like it. The pedal was also getting to the end of its travel, but there could be a variety of reasons for that. So we'll find out when we get the friction plate out. With a bit of luck, we might just have this ready to roll on Monday. I've got a show I want to take the stationary engine to. I'm booked in actually. That's in the town of East Grinstead for their May Day fair. We display engines in the high street, which is quite interesting. And with a bit of luck, I might have the Land Rover on display as well. So fingers crossed. Too bit, and to be honest, it looks like it's had a relatively recent clutch. So, I mean, I'd put that in again to be fair, but it is a bit contaminated with oil, as you'd expect with the state of that clutch release. So, yeah, not too bad, not what I was expecting. So, let's just have a closer look at the friction plate and pressure plate. Friction plate has very loose springs. They're not like that on the new one, and I have heard of that being a common source of rattles. There was certainly some noises coming from the bell housing, so I wouldn't be surprised if that's what that was, particularly evident at tick over. But the friction surfaces, apart from being a bit oily, look really rather good. Friction plate on the other hand is really rough, so that'd be why it's been that's sort of build up of oil and the friction material there. That'd be why it was quite juddery and the clutch could grab. Quite a bit of wear on it as well. But otherwise, nowhere near as bad as I was expecting. As for the flywheel, that is nice and smooth. So what we'll do while this is all apart, we'll just check the torque on the flywheel bolts, because a loose flywheel could also cause clutch judder, which it has suffered. And we're going to replace that spigot bush as well. So that is currently in the freezer. We can, if necessary, use a propane torch to heat that up. I think that would be reasonably safe to do here, given a few sensible precautions. So with an old Series 3 input shaft, we can just check the play in the crank spigot bearing. I think that's due replacement really. It Anyway, the floral bolts are tight, so that is a plus. It's one thing I was expecting to be loose that isn't. I decided rather than mess about, because there's so much wear in this bearing, rather than trying to hydraulic it out, I just only use the tried and tested axle blade method. Reason being, so much wear in it that I haven't got a drift, even an old input shaft that would actually put the grease in the right place, it would just squeeze out past it. Otherwise this is a very soft screwdriver, so I know I won't be doing any damage here. That's why I buy cheap ones, specifically for this kind of thing. So we just collapse that in at the front, that'll come out now. Wasn't too painful, and no damage at all to the crank. Probably taken me 5 minutes to remove that. Just to point out, I've got a fire extinguisher handy. Just even to warm this up a little will help an awful lot. Need much. So, there we are, it's been in the freezer. Just gonna straighten it up first. So the final part of fitting the crank spigot bush, just to take off the high spots. Then when I got a snug fit, as it were, it was a little bit too close, so I put plenty of EP90 around it. I just worked the new input shaft in there for a bit, wiped the oil off, a bit of fresh oil and so on, for about half an hour, and it's come up really nice. It's just lapped in a treat. So you see, no excess play, but it rotates as it should without binding up. So I know that when I put the gearbox together, as things get hot, it's not all going to bind up. So really pleased with that. And of course you can now see the benefit of doing this outside of the gearbox. If you were trying to line up the gearbox, having just tapped that bush in, expecting it to fit, you could be there all day, and you certainly read a lot of horror stories of people finding that the gearbox will go yay far on the studs and no further. So I think that is worth doing. Just a little point, one of the quirks of series Rovers. All the bolts, for example, in the chassis that hold the engine mounts, they're imperial. Bear in mind, this is the original engine. This is an M10 nut, modified for something, but you see, it fits perfectly. All metric threads on the engine. Well, I'm hoping you can see this okay. We have the new friction plate. Put some moly grease on the input splines first, just a tiny little bit to help it along. And the new pressure plate, all assembled on the input shaft. And then all we have to do, having degreased the flywheel, just get this lined up. The input shaft holds the friction plate nicely in place. I'll just find the mark that I made to match up with the flywheel, which is there. And then there are little pins all the way around. Line up. Then we can put the bolts in. Should have just put a little bit of copper slip, only a very small amount, on the bolts. And just hang it by the top one to start with. So having centralised the clutch, we've withdrawn the input shaft, and it's now time to torque up 25 pound foot in this case. Doesn't seem like a lot, but that's what the book says. Although I haven't chopped the engine, I haven't chopped the crank, not necessary here. Having said that, one final check. Should be alright, so we'll carry on with the gearbox rebuild tomorrow. With a bit of luck, might be able to put it in by the end of the day. So just to clarify a couple of points on the clutch. You can see it's not the same on both sides. It's this spigot that sticks out further, twice as far in fact as the other side. That is what you want facing the gearbox, so like that. Just to clarify something else, the reason I marked the flywheel was just in case of having to use the old clutch pressure plate again. It's good practice to put it back the same. If you're fitting a new one, it doesn't matter, as long as you line up these studs. In this case, the pin goes in the middle, the bolts will always line up. So as long as you do that, you're okay. It's also quite important to just nip those bolts down before you remove the input shaft. You don't have to use an input shaft, you can use a proper clutch alignment tool, but the input shaft is the ideal thing for the job. You know, I hope the video is of interest, and hopefully have another one of putting the gearbox in soon. Thanks for watching.